how it tastes and everything. Oh, I like to just feel how nice it is, and feel how cool it is, and it looks nice in the water when other people are swimming.
I like a smooth swim, so I guess I like it sort of just sailing over my body. But I like the splash too. It all depends on what mood you're in. You know, a nice dive in. It makes you feel like you're capturing the water almost. Well, it gives you a feeling of freedom. That's what. Yeah. If you dive in, and you can just sort of float along. And I like splashing. Yeah, I like splashing and making a noise. And just being able to move. You know, just really just kick and splash and move. That's what it is. It's freedom.
I would suggest that if this does become a reality, the thing that people will have to own in Toronto will be a boat in the summer. Certainly water sports will be the predominant sports in the city if the plans for Harbour City become a reality, and I for one hope that they will.
One of the items that makes Harbour City possible is the location or the development of land, natural development of land in front of Toronto due to the deposits of sand in Lake Ontario from the Humber and the drift pattern that develops along the Scarborough Bluffs, which follows a natural curve from Gibraltar Point over to Ontario Place. And the second point is that we have learned with the experience of Ontario Place how to landfill, the costs of landfill, the implications of landfill, so that we are technically capable now to, within the economic range, to fill land in this area and create approximately a stretch of 1,000 acres of new land within this part.
Well, I'd like to live there. I'd like to, if I could afford it, as long as it won't be expensive.
Practicality and sensible economy is what makes Harbour City a place that won't be just for the rich.
Well, here we are able to create land, new land, very close to the center of Toronto. The cost of approximately $50,000 per acre, which means slightly over $1,000 of land cost per dwelling unit or per house that is going to be built. All of this land, of course, is new land. None of it comes from the present Toronto Islands. This land and any other part of Toronto probably at the moment would cost 6 to 10 times more than what the creation cost for Harbour City would be. Well, this will allow us to build low and medium cost housing on this very desirable location.
It seems to me that Harbour City, as a development, just possibly, is a kind of fantasy that might come true. I wouldn't bet on it, but if by some miracle the provincial and municipal governments can bring this off, not in some shoddy second-rate imitation of Ebb Zeidler's original scheme, but can realize it in some way that's worthy of his imagination and the imagination of all the people who've been involved with Harbor City, then we've far surpassed even the dream or the fantasy of Expo 67. This is the most, potentially the most exciting new idea in urban living in North America. And of course, what's so great about it, it's more than an idea, it is a possibility. It can become real.
This is one of the first projects I've seen where they have consideration for the needs of the people.
I can hardly wait to move out there. I want the first apartment.
You have a community of people that like to be away from things. I mean, you're nice and close.
And I just hope that the city doesn't procrastinate this thing, let it die like so many of their major projects have done around here. I hope they really push it right through and get something done around here and at least show the world we've got something going.
The site of Harbor City will be between Ontario Place and the present Toronto Islands. It will not encroach upon the present Toronto Parkland, but it will stretch in front of them. It will be protected by a ring of outer islands, which will actually add another 200 acres to the present parkland.
The basic principle that has been used here is to stack two-story townhouses, one on top of each other, and have the upper level connected by a walkway. One part of each house will face a canal, as you see here or here in this part, while the other side of the house faces towards a area which is of a community use as a supervised play space for the children.
The idea, of course, in Half Harbor City is to not build a pseudo-city, but to build a true city and to put all the life that we have found now in our cities, or rediscovered probably in our cities, back into a community and not to separate it, parts of Dunvale, parts of Cumberland, parts of Bloor Street have great excitement that is built around the needs of people, the way people want to live, the way they want to move, the way they find enjoyment. And this is what we try to bring back into Harbor City.
I'd like to live right in here because it's very busy in front. It's a street. In fact, it's almost a plaza. But in back, it's a little pastoral scene and the water. The two totally different worlds right at your doorstep. This is really exciting. The whole place is full of variety. Every time you walk a little way, turn a corner, look around a corner, you're having a new experience. It isn't dull. It isn't routine. This is what a city ought to be. We've heard an awful lot about high density, and people have been led to believe that high density means high-rise living, monotony, barracks. It's not true at all. This is a very high-density project, and yet there's nothing impersonal or overwhelming or routine about it. This is one of the reasons why I personally think that this may well be the most important advance in city planning that's been made this century. It shows us what high-density living can be.
Well, one of the great attractions of Harbor City, of course, will be its water. Water always has been a fascinating thing to people.
Now, if you start to study water cities across the world of past and present and new things, you find that they do attract people for various reasons.
Reston was built around the lake and tried to incorporate water into the development of the small community so that housing and shopping and some aspects of working are focused around this small area, and in this aspect Reston has been highly successful. Reston's one example of putting water artificially into a housing development. Another case from the United States is Colombia. Well, I think what Colombia attempted is to bring a certain complexity back into the newly built city, to have an involvement of people, to create spaces for people and to create places to live for people.
Have been turning their backs to the water. They've been putting railroad tracks, highways, very low yield, often vacant industry between themselves and the water, and Toronto has done this. It's a great asset that isn't being used.
Well, in the days that I recall, back in about 1905 and 6, the Toronto Canoe Club was quite active, and in those days there was a stadium at Hanlon's Point, and yes, there was a switchback there and merry-go-round, and they'd have a band concert there and sold that pink popcorn, I remember, in blocks, and we'd go down and listen to the band there at night, and also there would be probably 30 or 40 members of the old Toronto Canoe Club who would take their girlfriends down to the clubhouse, and then they'd paddle these canoes over to the island.
I don't know whether you'll get a mass migration. I think one thing people have to realize is that the metropolitan area is growing by the rate of some 50 to 55,000 people every year. So even with the natural growth, Harbor City would only take 1 year to fill. Well, I think that it's an exciting concept. It's one that I personally endorse in principle. Let's work out the details as we come to them. The questions of land ownership, sewage, and everything else, I think it can certainly be overcome. I frankly would even like to live there myself. I think the idea of an island city certainly captures your imagination. Here is a plan that actually makes sense to me. I like it. It'll certainly be a terrific tourist attraction. Now you're gonna throw it all away and change your style for a smile. What's good for the goose? 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 It's good enough for you. Summer, sunny day.
Movement of the rapid transit system through Harbor City will be probably similar to the one of Montreal Expo 67, which had a great excitement to it. So as you move along, your vision will change. You will move over the water into a development, then in the open space again, into another development, through open space again, you see the islands. You will constantly see new part of very exciting landscape.
The islands are going to be constantly filled with people from this little city, and there's going to be no place for the people of Toronto to go.
The idea that the people from Harbor City go over and swamp the islands, the island parks, seems to me a great delusion. There's going to be a lot of park in Harbor City itself. The Harbor City people will probably be the least intensive users of the Toronto Islands parks.
This is why I like the Harbor City concept, is that you'll be able to walk from island to island. There will be little lagoons there, and I would hope little shops. And if we started right from the beginning and encourage the, I'm going to use the term, the European concept of the sidewalk cafe and items like that, I think then you would once again encourage the people back into the walk. Let's go over to Harbor City. There are plenty of places where we can stop, sit down, have a drink, whether it be a soft drink, a hard drink, or a hot drink, and just relax and watch the activity on the water.
Well, Harbor City represents, in a way, a new generation of planning. It's not old men's planning. I think it's young people's kind of place.
The difficulty is that there are just so many questions to be asked, so many guarantees to be given. I hope these questions can be asked. I hope they can be answered. Because Toronto could be a much better place for the building of Harbor City.
The first thing to do is to clean up the present pollution on the islands and make that parkland much more useful and a better place for the people who currently live in the city, those who do not escape now from the city to Muskoka and to cottages, those who find that their entire time is spent in the core of the city.
We will not add to pollution by building Harbor City, and I can assure you it will be our intentions to clean up the waterfront and make, as we're going to do at Ontario Place, to make sure that the people can use the water and just walk along and look at it and smell the dead fish. However, again, let me reassure you that if the Toronto City Council don't like what we propose or can't support what we propose, we just won't do it.
And I would like to ask Mayor Dennison, if I may, through the chair, to assure us that this development, like every other development that goes through the Building and Development Committee, will be subject to a Part 2 study.
Mayor Dennison, would you care to... Well, I'd like to say that that is the recommendation of the committee that is presently studying the harbor proposal.
This plan does not fill in any of the harbor. This plan creates entirely new land to the west of the present Island Airport. Alderman Conley is with me tonight, and I'm sure that his committee would want to complete their studies of it just as quickly as possible. And on with the job, as far as I am concerned. Thank you. Thank you for that.
The first portion of this community, the first island of Harbor City, is created, and people live there in the first stage, that they should be allowed to not only express themselves within the area, but also add advice to the succeeding stages, to the next stage. And this is the only way that we can see a continuing participation of the residents of Harbor City within the planning of the final community.
I should think one group of people that Harbor City will draw very much are people who are tired of using automobiles every time they want to go and get a loaf of bread or any time they want to deliver their child somewhere. In Harbor City, a car will hardly be necessary.
I used to live on Center Island when I was very young. And one of the great things about living there was that the main avenues were beautiful, wide sidewalks. There were no cars. The only private cars I would like to see on that place are the cars of the residents and of their guests and of those people who perhaps, as tourists, want to pay for a special permit for the right to make the tour of Harbor City.
This scheme is predicated on the idea that mass transit will be very heavily used within it, by visitors to it, and by people leaving it. This is, to my mind, one of its great advantages. It also, I think, ought to encourage modern water transportation, which a lake city like Toronto should be using, should be pioneering in.
One of the nice things about this is that if it's built, it'll get us away from the idea that a new community has to be a sort of necropolis of bleak high-rise, a bunch of tombstones with some token, rather windswept, inhuman park space, either of grass or cement.
Another of the great advantages, great social advantage of the kind of construction and planning we have here is that people of all different incomes and of differing family sizes and of differing tastes and choices can be mixed up together. We don't have to segregate the old people from the young. We don't have to segregate the middle income from the rich and from the poor.
I would like to see, before this thing is built, an absolute guarantee from the Ontario government and from Toronto City Council and any other body we can get that there be a social mix, that there be all sorts and conditions of men and women in this project. Low-income families, old people, very poor and perhaps very rich. We need a few eccentric old ladies.
One of the most important things about this scheme, and one of the reasons I think it's important not only for Toronto but for the whole art of city planning, is the construction method that the architects contemplate. Now, because of this system, restaurants, stores, small offices, houses can occur throughout where it's convenient for them, and in the future there will be a great flexibility. Formerly residential buildings can be quickly converted into little restaurants, into stores, even into classrooms. Now this is the way a living city operates. It changes over time.
And if this thing is built, of course, people in the rest of Toronto will simply not be satisfied. They will want something of this excitement and variety and intimate human scale. In other developments, not of course just in and around Toronto, but elsewhere in Ontario and in the rest of the world.
I would say that once the people see the trucks starting to move in with fill, and Ontario Place has certainly showed how fast this can be done, they're going to be just deluged with requests for land, as it's going to be built in sections. I would say that long before the second section is planned, the first section will be completely sold.
We have created a city of separation, a place to work and a place to sleep and maybe a place to enjoy ourselves. But we have always felt that we must keep these things apart and also that we must keep people apart. We don't have to evacuate the downtown after 5 o'clock, and we don't have to evacuate suburbia at 8 o'clock in the morning when we all have to go to work.
You can't isolate dormitory quarters and so-called working quarters, but that the Harbor City could be this fused life where you can do everything, where at lunchtime you can enjoy a small restaurant where you can sit and look at the water, or where you can fish, or where you can use your canoe or your sailboat, and where you don't have to escape on the weekend to find what you have been working for.